Hello and welcome to Open Your Mind Radio. You have myself, Alan James.
And you have myself, Santa Claus.
It's
Stephen. Stephen George. Good evening.
It's Sunday the 21st December 2014 and Santa is going to be here in a few days for all the kids, and I bet the kids are jumping up and down. Very excited.
Mine were jumping up and down.
Yes. Right, okay, right. Tonight we thought we'd kind of have a kind of laid-back show and chill out because, you know, all the kind of serious stuff we do during the year, it's nice when it gets to Christmas to kind of relax and have a bit of fun, have a bit of comedy. And no better a man to actually get on the show than Aidan Killian, who's a well-known comedian. I'm sure a lot of people know Aidan. He's been on the show before last year, actually. But for people who don't know him, we're going to get him on and we're going to have a good chat with Aidan. And he has a few good funny stories to tell us about things that happened to him while he was kind of waking up to this process of what's going on, the corruption in the government and letters from credit card companies and banks and all that kind of stuff. So we'll be getting into that and talking about that. And of course, he has a new book out as well, so we'll talk to him about that. But before we do that, we'll find out what the communication channels are.
Yes, we will. The communication channels on this fine festive evening. Excuse me. I don't know where that came from. The communication channels, please, Mary.
The communication channels are email info@oymireland.com, by phone 046 927 1212, and you can also contact us direct through the OYM chat room.
Amazing how Mary never makes any mistakes. It's always me. Anyway, yes, 046 927 1212 is the magic number for the studio. We also you can also ring us in from Northern Ireland or anywhere else in the world, and all you have to do is put 00353 469 271 212. We also have the anti-social media Facebook. You can check us out there as well. You can log on to oamradio.com. You will see the Facebook icon on the left-hand side. You will also see the YouTube. You can check out some videos. We also have the live chat as well. You can just click on the button there and you can join in the chat room. We're also going to be monitoring People's Internet Radio chat room as well tonight. So hello to everyone on peoplesinternetradio.com. Alan.
Cheers, Steve. Okay, and just to say, the other guest that we're going to have on later on after Aidan is Finbar Markey from the Land League. We had the launch party on Wednesday night. It was very successful. Great turnout there. We're going to be talking about that later anyway. And we're going to get an update on what the Land League
doing.
I think me and you will have to put in our teeth for tonight. But Steve, you're going to tell us.
I'm going to tell you something. Yes, the news that is making the news. Yes. We put up a video for the Rocking Around the Christmas Tree song that we played last week. That was the ongoing work of myself, Alan, and Mary. We'd done the Rocking Around the Christmas Tree song, and it was launched on it was launched there last week. And I think we've probably sold about 500,000 copies at this stage. It's gone gold or platinum or silver or wood, whatever they say anyway. But it was played last week, and if yous are really good, we might play it again tonight. I actually got some good feedback from it during the week. Again, from the mammy. The mammy.
Oh, very good.
Where would you be without your mammy? Yeah, she said to me there yesterday, we were doing the Christmas visit. I was just saying to Aidan there earlier that we'd done the Christmas visit, and she said to me, I heard your song. And I went, yeah, what did you think of it? I never knew you could sing. And I'm thinking, of course you did. You've heard me singing Happy Birthday, you know. But, yeah, so she was well impressed. But anyway, yeah, so the video was up on YouTube that Alan put together during the week for Rocking Around the Christmas Tree, which is, well, our parody of said song. It's worth checking out. You know, get the views up there. And, yeah, anyway. Right, next.
I got feedback on the song as well.
Yes.
And
from your mammy, was it?
I said no from a neighbour of mine who actually listened to it, and I did say no auto-tune was used in the proceedings of doing that recording.
Yes, that's all natural. There's no messing around with anything there. That's all. That's what you hear is what you get.
No auto-tune. So there you go. Not saying that was perfect, but it was no auto-tune used anyway, because I wouldn't know how to use it anyway.
Anyone wondering what auto-tune is, stay tuned. I'm going to be talking about that in a couple of minutes' time.
Right.
Anyway, we are now on unseen.is. Yes, we are. UNSWEN.is. The email is oymradio@unseen.is, and we are also on scene.is as Alan and Steve OIM Radio. If you do send an email to oimradio@unseen.is, please let us know or give us time, as we won't be checking it very often. We just decided to set it up, but we're not going to check it.
Oh, we will. It's only news, so we won't be doing it as regular as we would with Facebook.
Yeah. And we are also on Seen, SEEN.IS. And we have a group set up there that you can join if you so wish. People who are wondering what the hell he is talking about. This is kind of, it's people who are being, well, getting a bit fed up with Facebook censoring posts and pulling down posts and all sorts of shenanigans going on. There's a Seen.IS and Unseen.IS. They are, it's kind of like social media. I think, well, one is kind of like social media. It's kind of like Facebook, but without all the BS that goes on that's attached to it. And Unseen, I think that's, is that kind of the Skype type thing?
That's just the email.
Oh, it's not Skype type of a thing, no?
No, not unless you pay money for it, I think.
Oh,
yeah,
we
I
don't.
Think you have to pay.
Pay!
You get a free email, and then there is a payment system where if you pay,
you can
use extra services with
it. Right, right. We don't be paying anything.
No.
We don't like paying. No. But there you go, Seen.IS and Unseen.IS. They're actually set up, their server's set up in Iceland. So it's kind of outside the remit of the Facebook people. So, you know, if we post something that's, you know, maybe a little bit derogatory that our government don't like, they won't be able to get it removed, and Facebook won't be, you know, in their pocket and removing stuff and all this sort of carry on. Anyway, there you go. Check us out.
So we can expose what we need to expose on
that. We will expose ourselves on that, yeah.
Any information comes in. Right, before the show started earlier today, I got a phone call from one of our regular listeners, Chris. Thanks, Chris, for making the phone call and giving us some information. Chris's daughter lives in Australia and she's home at the moment for Christmas. And obviously, we heard what happened in Australia and we all, you know, straight away you could say it's a false flag. Now, apparently, the Australian people were not very happy about the Australia backing the Americans regarding ISIS. So I suppose psychologically the best thing to do is, how can we get the Australian people on our side? Oh, let's have a false flag and pretend something happened and it was ISIS's fault. So this is the plan of attack. So apparently Chris's daughter came home and she was saying about how they feel down there about what's going on. So they went really over the top, and you were shutting down train stations and everything else, just to inconvenience people, to make them angry, and just to kind of say, well, there you go, we see, you said you didn't want to go and back the Americans, and there you go, this is what these ISIS people are very nasty, this is what they do, and we all know it's a false flag, because that's what they do, that's how the elite do it. So, everybody's probably heard, it was on the news anyway, So that's why I didn't spend a lot of time kind of looking into it, because I knew straight away, I mean, that's what they're doing these days. They're getting so desperate. The false flags are so obvious now. They're coming out the way they're doing it, you know. Just another kind of quickie. If we would love to get our hands on a pair of night vision goggles, Generation 3, if possible. I don't know whether, you know, because obviously we were talking to James Gilliland and stuff like that, and it'd be brilliant to actually get a set of them. Now, I know they are very expensive, but we're just going to put it out to the universe and see what happens anyway. It'd be really great to get a pair, or, you know, a pair that's as good as Generation 3, so we can see what's going on, because apparently there's an awful lot going on. There was a video on YouTube earlier where you could blatantly see things going on in the sky. You think, what the hell is that? So it'd be great if we could get them. But how's your week, Steve?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked. Generation 3, we even settled for Generation 2 or Generation 1, doesn't matter. When you talk about that incident that happened during the week in Australia, it's funny because I'm just going to say I spoke with someone during the week. I'm not sure if this person may be listening, so I'll just say I spoke with someone during the week. And we spoke of the incident, and I said when he told me about the incident, I said, now hang on a second there now. You know, sometimes things aren't as they look, and you have to do a little bit of digging, and, you know, you scratch the surface, and you learn a whole lot more than just by listening to mainstream media. And he said to me, I remember when you were talking about that whole Boston bombing thing before. I says, yeah, and Sandy Hook. I said, you know, sometimes you just have to scratch the surface, do a little bit of digging, a little bit of research, and you'll get the other side of the story, or you may find out a different side of the story. And I just wanted to, do you ever just want to reach out and just throttle somebody? He said to me,
McKenna Kenny, yeah,
among others. But he said to me, look, I know where you come from and I can appreciate it, but I'd rather just, you know, listen to the news and that's enough for me. I don't really want to be looking into things or anything like that. And I says, but do you not feel that by just listening to the news, what's on there, you're only getting one side of a story? And I said, if your two kids were fighting at home, and, you know, one kid's going to be saying, oh, he said this and she said that, and I said, you're not going to just listen to one of your children and then make a decision based on one side of a story. I said, you can't make an informed decision. You have to listen to other sides. But he said to me, look, I know, I appreciate where you come from, but no, I'm happy enough. I don't really want to start looking into all that sort of stuff. And I just thought, you know what, walk away now. So I did, and that was that. You want to add anything to that before I?
No, that's a good analogy. I like it.
Yeah. Just reach out and smack somebody. what else? The music industry, we talked about auto-tune there just real quick, and I did see an article during the week on Russia Today. It was plastered all over Facebook. The link is up there in the chat, but I will also post it up again if anybody wants to listen to it just for the laugh. See me this auto-tune thing. It's like a magic black box that, if you can't sing, it'll make you sing. It matches your voice to the music. And I know we joked about it earlier when we done our song. If we had it, we would have used it. But we didn't. But seeing me, it's rife in the music business. And the frontman from Milli Vanilli, can't remember the chap's name, but he was interviewed on this Russia Today piece, and he tells you about it. Even singer Britney Spears, they play some audio from her without the auto-tune and then with the auto-tune, and it's amazing. Like, without the auto-tune, she's just some drunk young one in a nightclub.
I haven't seen it yet, but I want to see it.
Oh, so you want to see this? It's well worth the watch. It really, really is. And it just kind of exposed what's going on. I let my wife and my daughter. It's not that I let them watch it. They watched it with me. My daughter was left kind of with her mouth open because she just assumed that, you know, when you're kind of a teenage girl, you just assume all these teenage boys that are in these bands that they just have a gift for singing. Well, even she was kind of blown away. She now realizes they don't, and that anybody can do it. And then we were talking about, I was talking about, again, I posted this link up earlier, and I will repost it again, the revolution that's going on in Spain at the moment. There's a whole list of things that have come up on the internet. Is it true? I don't know. But if they're doing them up there, you can be sure they're going to do them over here, whereby if we have a protest, you know, we go out there and we have a protest, let's say Irish Water or Sputnik Meters, and we stand there, then there'll be an act or a statute that will cover that. You know, if we're out there, oh, no, you can't do that. Something between a 600 and 30,000 euro fine. This is what's happening in Spain at the moment. I will repost the link. They're talking about unlawful gatherings, you know, this, that, and the other. This, everything, every base is covered. So it basically means that if I was to walk out on the road in the morning and decide I don't want a meter outside my home and I stand up, well, I could be fined up to 30,000 euro, and it goes on and on and on. I'll post the link, have a look yourselves, check it out. And then the last one I want to talk about, another link I seen during the week from Larkin Rose. Again, Larkin talks about, you know, people who are going out there and protesting. Like we did, we went out, a lot of the Irish said, we want the government to say no to water meters and vote no and say no and blah, blah, blah. And then Larkin Rose put this video up of how they see you, which is very, very interesting. So it's kind of looking at us, the protesters, from the government's perspective. And it kind of looks as they are the master and we are the slaves. And he says, in no time in history have the slaves ever pleaded with the master, and the master has kind of given in to the slaves and said, oh, yeah, okay, I'll give you freedom. It's not going to happen. So, you know, basically the message I got out of it is that we're wasting our time and we need to kind of fight fire with fire, which I think makes sense. It may not suit everybody and we don't condone violence, but I think protesting and asking the master to please change his mind and you know, let us have a few crumbs from his table, it's not going to happen. It's a waste of time, because once you see it from, and this is something I never thought of until I watched that video, you have to watch it from the other person's perspective, from the government's perspective, and how they actually view us. Anyway, it's quite interesting. I will post the links up. Well, post them up now, and I'll post them up again at the end. But there we go. That's pretty much my week in a nutshell. How's yours?
Yeah, not too bad. Not too bad.
Beat that.
There's a chap on the chat facility, Human. Yeah, he just said that not all attacks are false flag. I know not all of them are, but you know, this is what they do. That's their tactics, and that's how they do it. For this one anyway, for Australia. Right, okay, now I posted up a video regarding, from Michael Tellinger, in relation to promissory notes. And it was a very, very good video from Michael. And I'm going to be suggesting it to a few people. Maybe we should try it over here in Ireland and in the UK. And maybe America, you could try it as well. And it was 25 minutes of information just about promissory notes, how he used them, successfully used them in South Africa regarding his outstanding debts on mortgages. Now, he does say that on the video, you can only use promissory notes with government and with banks. So does that mean that the likes of the property tax and all that kind of stuff, you could actually pay using a promissory note if it's a government thing? So that's my next question. So, yes, if you can use it with the banks and it works with the banks, then there's no reason why you can't use it with the government and then do a promissory note for your you know, LPT house property tax, or maybe your inland revenue, or any tax at all from the government, anything from the government. You know, maybe your tax on your car, that's a government thing, you know. So this is what I'm thinking with this promissory note. As long as it's something from the government or something from the banks, then technically, according to Michael, that's how you use it. There's no point going into your local shop or your DIY store and using a promissory note, because that is kind of a civil thing and their business as well, trying to make money. But when it comes to government and banking, that's where it differentiates. So I'd like to kind of look into that a bit more. So I will be talking to a few people about that and see if we can get like a couple of cases together, maybe via the Land League or the Hub or something, and try it and see how we get on. Because we've nothing to lose, really, with doing that. Again, we had, as I say, the Land League's going to be on, fingers crossed, later on, about 8:15. And the Land League County Meath launch party was on Wednesday, just gone. Ben was there, Ben Gilroy was there, Tom Darcy was there, Ben and Tom were talking, and a couple of other people got up and they were talking. And they were talking about communication and how to get the information out there and how to wake people up and everything else. And everybody was talking about the likes of Facebooks and websites and that, which is great. But nobody actually mentioned alternative radio. Nobody actually turned around and said anything about alternative radio. So I felt, you know, on behalf of the alternative radio stations in Ireland, I felt something had to be said. So I did kind of cheekily get up in up to the stage, took the microphone and spoke to the group of people at the launch party, and said to them that I was representing, I'm just putting a word in for alternative radio, and said, don't forget, we are out there, we get people on, we talk about what's going on, and we expose things that have been, you know, have been going on, and give people platforms to talk, to get the frustration out and say what you want to say, because the mainstream media will not give them the time and not allow them to do it. So we'll just ask our listeners to let people know that we are there. Alternative radio stations are out there. Even if you don't like, you know, OIM, for example, well then, fine, go to, you know, people's internet radio. They've loads of DJs over there, they've loads of hosts over there, loads of shows on there, or any other, you know, alternative media radio station. You know, so there's a variety in Ireland, and we just, there, you know, what we're trying to do is get the information out there. And I'm just amazed that with everybody in the room talking about ways of getting the information out there, nobody suggested the alternative media radio. So I just thought that had to be said on the night, and I'd like to think they appreciated it, just to say it's another kind of avenue they can use. It was a good launch party, it was a good night, everybody enjoyed it, it was very good. And the one last thing we're going to mention before we get Aidan on is I got an email from Dr. Carol Rosen. Dr. Carol Rosen has been on the show, she's a friend of OIM, and you probably remember she's was a missile and defence consultant and worked with Werner von Braun. And she sent me over an email saying about painkillers, and she said Tylenol can kill you. A new warning admits popular painkiller causes liver damage and death. Tylenol. Now, I don't know whether we have that over here.
We do. You can get that over here. And I seen that article that she refers to, and it frightened the bejesus out of me, because the day beforehand, I was actually in a chemist, and I was buying, my sinuses were blocked, so I went in and I was buying a popular over the counter. we can just say it. Sudafed, there you go. I was buying a box of Sudafed to unblock my sinuses, because they generally work. And every time I go to buy them, the person behind the counter says, these are not suitable if you're taking medication for high blood pressure. I went, yeah, okay, fine. And then I just said to myself, I said to herself, actually, I wonder why I keep getting told this. What's the connection? And then when I read that article that Carol spoke of, it's actually mentioned one of the same ingredients that's in Tylenol, it's also in Sudafed. And again, yeah, it's in the Sudafed, so it can cause liver damage. And if you take enough of it, it can quieten you permanently. So, I won't be using that again. So I'm going to have to find out an alternative to that product for blocked sinuses.
Yeah. I mean, I hate taking any pharmaceutical tablets anyway. I mean, they're probably, you know, painkillers sometimes, but I try and avoid them as best I can, you know. Okay. Let's get a guest on and let's have a chat and let's have a catch up what Aidan's doing. Good evening, Aidan. How are you doing?
Hello. Can you hear me?
We can indeed. How's things with you?
Oh, I'm good. Well, I was great until I heard about the sinuses situation, and then I realised, oh my God, the world is... Some people have it so tough.
I know.
I don't know how I'm going to sleep tonight thinking about your misery.
Well, there you go. Steve's going to have to change his painkillers, I think.
God love me.
God love him.
Steve, a few drops of iodine, a few walks on the beach, some kelp will fix that. I'm telling you, iodine, man, get some iodine. That'll clear it.
There you go. Iodine tablets in the health shop. There you go. Pop a few of them.
Right,
there.
Thanks for that, Dr. Keely. The bills in the post. Check in the post.
Oh, we don't believe in titles. Aidan doesn't believe in titles. Mr. Dr. King, you can just address me as your eternal brother of light. That'll do.
Right, okay.
My brother from another mother. There you go.
Can we just call you bro for short? It's going to be quicker.
All right, that'll do.
Okay, all right, bro. Okay. Listen, people, we've been on the show before last Christmas and we had a great show. And as I said before we went live, there's a lot more people waking up now and they're realising about what's going on. And maybe, you know, for the first time they've heard about Aidan Killian and they're saying, who's that? So just for them people, can you tell us a bit about, you know, your background and who you are and how you got into comedy?
35 years ago, my parents had sex. 34 years ago, I was born. I became a banker. I did finance because I wanted money. Worked in an investment bank. They sent me to Tokyo. I made more money. And then I quit and decided to become a comedian. Became a comedian. I shit at it. I lost my properties. I lost my shares. I lost all my economic value. But I realized a much stronger value that I had. My ability to live without fuck all money and to do what I enjoy. And then I started making people laugh. And then I started actually realizing... there's a lot going on in the world, and I sort of went through the rabbit hole for a while, and then I got out of it, and I just sort of laughed at it, and I started talking about these issues on stage, and some of those things were interesting for some people, like the show Take the Red Pill that goes into the banking corruption and so on, and the name and all of that. And then my last show was Jesus versus Buddha, which talks about the sovereignty of a human being through Jesus and Buddha. So let's drop the religion thing and just go down and talk about what did they really say. I mean, a lot of things, but one of them is look within. The truth is inside you. Peace is found within. The kingdom of God is inside you. Now, if that's the truth, if the truth is inside of you, that means there's no king, no queen, nobody above you, no authority, except unless you give somebody else the power to be your doctor, to be your king, or whatever it is, your master, as you were talking about earlier on. So, the reality is, I do comedy because I don't have any other choice. It's what I need to do now. You know, I know it's for me to do, and I talk about issues that I enjoy, and that is anything related to the truth. Ta-da! How's that for an introduction?
That was great, right? We'll see you next week. Good luck.
All right, thank you. God bless now.
No, Jesus, fair play. I mean, yeah, I remember you telling us that before, that you got involved in the banking and then you kind of had your eureka moment and comedy. And I know you have been referred to before, and I certainly said it. I have said it to you I was going to say to your face, but to your, the last time you were on, you will be the equivalent of Bill Hicks here in Ireland, a man who is getting the message out there, educating people through the art of comedy and laughter. And I think it's a brilliant way to do it.
Now, that's a beautiful compliment. I'd see Bill as a prophet. And we need to remember that a lot of Bill's stuff didn't work. A lot of people didn't go for him. He never made it in America. What I love about his stuff is it's eternal. What he talks about, you can watch over and over again. It's not that you hear a joke and then someone tells you the same joke again, you cut it off and go, oh, I've heard that one already, because it's not funny. But when you see something that resonates inside of you and you realize, fuck, yes, this is unfair, this system is broken, and he gives us a way out, and it always ends with love. Well, it doesn't always end with love, but a lot of the time he ends with love with his material. I think he was talking about A Course in Miracles. Are you guys aware of that book?
No, I didn't see it. Tell us about it.
There's a book from the 70s, A Course in Miracles. I wouldn't be an expert on it, but one of the things is there's a 365-day meditation. Every day you meditate on forgiveness. You start off forgiving, you know, your enemies or your perceived enemies. Then you start forgiving your family or the person you meet in the shop. And ultimately you start forgiving yourself, and you realize that you don't have any animosity. You don't really have any hatred or anger towards other people when you get far enough into it. Obviously, right at the start, you know, you're angry with everybody, but all of that stuff is imaginings. It's false. It's not real. And this is what you learn in the book. But my understanding is that's what Bill was doing, because that's the book that he was reading when he died, and he was reading it for the second time when he gave it to his mother. And if that's the case, and then you look back at his material, you see a full circle of human emotions. You see the destruction, the pain, the misery that he had, and the anger. You know, when he saw society for what it was, enslaving humanity, and nobody was listening. And then he had disdain and disgust for the apathy that he was faced with, you know, looking at all the human beings who wouldn't listen to his material because they wanted cock jokes. But beyond that, he had ultimate compassion for them, ultimate forgiveness. He accepted them anyway, as apathetic as they were.
Yeah.
And that's one of the many reasons why I enjoy Mr. Bill Hicks, even though he might not like to be called Mr.
Well, this is what we're dealing with today, because as Steve said earlier, when you're dealing with people who are asleep and apathetic and don't see what's going on, or they have the I'm okay, Jack attitude, you know, it is hard to deal with it. And I'm sure if you're up on stage, have you done a gig or been at gigs when you've been talking about some of the stuff, and because people are not aware of what's going on, it just completely goes over their head?
Yeah, it's happened to me a lot, and sometimes it's my fault too, because the reality is it's my job to be able to bridge that gap, and sometimes I should do it, but sometimes I have a form of arrogance or something where I don't bother doing it, and I have this sense, well, fuck them, if they're not there, they should be. But that's not fair, because I wasn't awake. It's not so long ago that I didn't have any idea of what was going on, and maybe fucking they're meant to be asleep. You know, maybe they're meant to be blissful ignorance. Maybe they're not meant to realize, you know, the pharmaceutical companies are trying to fuck them. Maybe they're not meant to realize that the court system's there to accumulate funds at their expense, and the police, Garda Síochána, Protectors of Peace are there to ensure that they do what they're told, or they'll be used against them. Maybe if they don't realize that, they're happier. And if they're happier, are they not resonating at a higher level than they would be if we wake them up quickly with a jolt? Because if you're woken up with a jolt, the first thing I do is I smack the person who wakes me up. I think people, in some ways, need to be waking up slowly. You might not agree with that. I don't know if you do. But I'm aware that sometimes if I go in too deep, too fast on stage, people will sort of revolt against me. Even if they want to laugh, they nearly refuse to, because they're like, fuck you, you know, everything's okay. Don't hit me with that. I'm going to
Well,
masturbate to X Factor.
It's all kind of a cognitive dissonance. You know, and some people are just comfortable in their environment. And some people wake up with a shock because something happens in their life where it's just immediate. And other people, it's a gradual thing. You know, some people start waking up maybe with the Irish water meters and the installation of that. And then they start questioning on other things. And they say, well, the very government is like this with Irish water. What else have they been up to, and what are they doing? And all of a sudden, the journey going down the rabbit hole begins to happen. And then you start asking questions. And that's the kind of the gradual side. But for other people, it might be a sickness or an illness or something like that. And you find out about pharmaceutical drugs and industry and them trying to sell, you know, drugs that, you know, like chemo, which 75% of doctors say they don't recommend anyway. And yet, you know, or they might have lost a loved one to cancer, and then they've been told, or they find out that, well, actually just 6 or 7 cures to cancer that don't involve pharmaceutical drugs. And they say, well, why didn't I know about this? And then people say, well, because they're not going to tell you because they'd lose money. And then that anger kicks in, you know?
And it all comes back to the simple thing. Why would we ever, ever ask somebody else, you know, for make a decision on our behalf without fully understanding the consequences? I mean, if I had a child and somebody says, you know, hey, I'm going to feed that child for you, don't worry about what's in the food, and I say, okay, well, isn't that irresponsible of me? So, yeah, maybe they're giving the child McDonald's or something, and I don't bother looking into it. But then if I did look into it, I might realize, well, that food doesn't really have the nutritional value that I think is in the best interest of this human being. And unfortunately, we don't always do that for ourselves, not just for children. I've lost track. I got distracted there. What are we talking about?
No, that's okay. No, we're just saying about, you know, people not being aware. As you say, parents. We had the issue there recently with vaccines. You know, the parents bring their kids in to the doctor, and they trust the doctor and trust the medical system, and the kids are getting vaccines, and some kids, unfortunately, with the vaccines, had allergic reactions and had major effects from it. And it's up to the parents to actually go and say, well, hang on a minute, I don't want my son or my daughter to have a vaccine. I want to read the instructions for us to see what's in this vaccine. And the fact that, well, number one, they don't work. Number two, you're pumping your child full of heavy metals. And number three, the vaccine companies, the pharmaceuticals, are immune from prosecution anyway. So surely any company...
Isn't that a fascinating point? Immune from prosecution. So if we damage your child, if we put your child into a paralyzed situation and he is financially destroyed, and his life is destroyed for the rest of his life until he dies, okay?
Yeah.
Or perceived death. No such thing as death. But anyway, right? Let's just say that is what they do. Now, why would anybody go into a contract with somebody who's taking no financial responsibility?
Exactly. So,
to get a vaccine, fine. Yeah, give me a vaccine, great. But you're going to take full financial equitable responsibility for your actions. So if I get sick, you're going to pay me money. If we were to bring it down to a monetary value.
Yeah, yeah. Right?
So let's say I get sick for a week. What's that worth? Okay, I want $5,000. Now, let's say you make me sick for 10 years. What do I want? I want $50 million. Now, if that was the case, and that's the normal case in business, if you or I set up a business and we sell cakes and somebody comes into our shop and they get sick, well, they can sue us.
Yeah.
And we would have to pay them the money. So by them washing the hands of it, by them doing a punches pile on it, I mean, the reality is silence is acquiescence. They are responsible. They are responsible. And whether they face it in court or not, they, you know, they are responsible. They'll pay for it karmically in this life and or the next.
Yeah.
And I don't mean that in a threatening way. I'm not going to go around kicking the shit out of the people who make vaccines because I don't have that much time on my hands.
Yeah, well, it's funny you should say about the whole karmic side, because we have talked about this on the show, and we had Ralph Ring on, who's a scientist. He's a chap in his 80s who was building anti-gravity aircrafts in the 50s. And he's an expert in natural law. And he said, when you're dealing with natural law, it's very easy. Everything should be very easy because it's a natural law. He said, when you try and force something, that's not natural. So we asked him about the law of karma, and he said, of course, he said, why wouldn't it be karmic? You know, the energy, you know, you put out negative energy, guess what's going to come back? It's the law of attraction. And I know there's people out there who might say, oh yeah, that's all kind of Buddhist karma stuff, blah, 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 blah. But, you know, I've seen karma come back around on some people quicker than I thought would happen. And I do have a belief in karma. I mean, this is my own personal opinion, because I've seen it happen. And so what's your take on it, and have you seen any?
For me, like, I accept karma as just a reality. It's just a normal thing. It's really simple. If I'm in bad humor and I go out to my family and I'm in bad humor and I snap at them because they're annoying me, because I've less patience than I normally would. Granny says, do you want a scone? Do you want a cup of tea? Do you want a cup of tea? She says it one time too many. And I snap at her. Well, she's going to be upset. And the reality is, if I see her upset, then I'm going to be upset. So it has like... an instant effect that I can't think of the word that goes up. Yeah, an instant feedback. So it's sort of like, it's kind of like comedy in a way. If you go up and you're shit at comedy and people don't laugh, well then, then that silence makes you feel even worse and worse and worse. But likewise, we can switch it around the other way around. So if you are in good humor and you walk out and you go to the shop and you smile at someone, there's a moment that they may or may not smile back. But eventually somebody will, and you get that instant gratification, like, oh, wow, look at that. And then it gets passed on, so it's like a spiraling effect that you can have on the universe.
Exactly, and that's what it's all about, good energy. I always think, and I always say, personally, I kind of focus on staying away from negative people as much as I can. But listen, it's not so much about this, this is more about you and your interview. Is there any kind of antidotes or any stories that you've come across with Irish water in your travels? That have you been, the last time you were telling us about the letters that you're writing in peace and love to the bankers, and has anything developed since we last had you on regarding the banks or Irish water?
Well, there's two separate questions. Irish water is that's a big conversation itself, and I'm sure you guys have been talking about it quite a bit, like most of the people in the country. Is Irish water waking people up? It's certainly putting a lot of people in a situation where they're forced to realise that it's a possibility that the state does not have their best interests at heart. It's becoming quite clear now that Dennis O'Brien runs the media. News Talk, Spin FM, 98 FM, independent newspapers. Now, if one human being owns, and I'm not making him the enemy, it'd be very foolish for me to turn around and go, oh, Dennis O'Brien's the bad guy, let's all hate him. That doesn't make sense. The structure allowed it, the system allowed one human being to run the media. Now, maybe if it was Gandhi who ran the media, maybe it would be in our interest. Now, I don't know what kind of a man Dennis is. Maybe he's a great guy. Maybe he is as enlightened as Jesus. For all I know, he is. But looking at the content of his media, I'd say that's highly fucking unlikely. And it seems that this media is being used to manipulate and lie to the Irish people. I don't know how to say it any other way, because sometimes when you look at what's going on in Irish water, if you're at the protests and you can see families, you see nice people, pensioners, kids, you see students, you see naive human beings thinking, oh, let's hold up our signs and go for a walk and sing songs. From the mountain to the sea, Irish water will be free. And they're all happy, and then they think that maybe it'll make a difference, just like signing one of those petitions, like it's going to make a difference. But then you get there and you realise the state have dogs, they've got riot police, they've got goddamn helicopters and snipers there. For what? The dissidents, the terrorists? So it's kind of like a, like the what I'm getting at is the distance between the reality and then what's in the newspaper. So if we look at the newspapers, we're going to see angry terrorists, ISIS-like human beings, when they're describing the people who get arrested. And then if you look at the situation where they get arrested, you know, there's a cop punching a young female. And that makes me sad. You know, when I see the reality, obviously that's not always the case all the time, but I've been at the protests. I've seen it with my own eyes. I've witnessed men acting as Garda Síochána and acting against, you know, the natural law. You know, the law is gravity. If you drop a glass, it's going to fall.
Yeah.
And it's going to smash. And if you push people too far, eventually they're going to push back. And that's kind of worrying, isn't it? You know, because people say, no way, we can't pay. A lot of people say they can't pay, and that's why they're waking up. But when they're forced into, I think it's beyond that. I think it goes further than this Irish water. It's not about money. For me, putting a meter in everybody's bed is complete and utter control. Putting a meter on people's house, the access to turn someone's water. If you turn one human being's water off in this country, we failed as a nation. It's an extremely dangerous situation to give one human being the power to turn off other people's ability to live. I mean, we're made of water. We are water. It's like saying you can't be yourself. You can't be yourself anymore. And not only that, but just to really piss you off, we're going to make you pay for it, even though we put fluoride in.
Yeah.
Why don't they just come up and piss in our faces and then send us a bill for it?
That's one way of looking at it, all right. Well, I do agree. I mean, at the moment, the people have had enough. And what about these people who are doing it? What's your take, and what's their mentality?
I mean, the ones protesting are great. You see all the women in Tala with the all-night vigil, or the people dancing. I mean, really, the Irish, the Celtic spirit's coming out there, isn't it?
Yeah, well, what about the likes of Enda and his cohorts, and why they keep pushing and pushing and pushing, knowing, well, maybe they know, or maybe the PR team is just protecting him, and he doesn't realise, he thinks he's doing it for the common good.
Or do they want us to snap? Are they waiting for that snap to bring in martial law?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know about that because I'm only guessing, right? I like to believe that all human beings are good, and we can go extreme with this, so we can pick anybody. The obvious example is always Hitler, and I do like to think that beneath that, he had some serious qualities. And I'm not using this for effect, and I'm not saying anything disrespectful to all the human beings that died during the war. But if we go into it and we look at it, I wonder, did he fully know what was going on? I wonder, did he fully intend to harm human beings? Or did he want to create a better future? Maybe his intentions were good, but they were misplaced. Okay? For me, I think that all human beings mean well.
Well, maybe he was just a puppet being used again by the system.
That's a possibility, and the more I look into it, I see so many different bits and pieces, and I can't know the truth for sure, because the truth gets distorted and twisted, and, if we look at even today's news, how can I tell what happened? I can't tell what happened in the Irish famine or the genocide. I can't tell what happened in the World War. There's so much that went on, but I do follow the money, and I see who gets rich after.
Yeah.
So, yeah, a lot of people die, and the Jews die, the Irish die, the gays die, the English die, the French die. Everybody died, right? 40 million Russians are dying, 20 million Russians or something like that. And the Germans got it bad, too. A lot of Germans died, and, the women were attacked afterwards. Terrible stuff happened to all over Europe, all over the world, in fact, right? But if we look at it, the poor people died, and some rich people got very, very rich.
Yeah, exactly, which so always...
If we just look at what happened afterwards, we give the quick summary. 100 million people died, and some people got very, very rich.
Yeah.
And that's suspicious for me.
Yeah, well...
Why is it always those rich people don't get killed?
All wars are bankers' wars, anyway.
Wars are bankers' wars.
You know... Well, if you look at who's behind it, now I'll tell you what, we're going to go over, we have a handful of questions because we know we're a little bit limited in time. So,
let me just finish with Enda. Okay. I think Enda is a very weak man by looking at him. Now that seems like a judgment. I just mean I wouldn't trust him to babysit my kids. I don't have kids, but he's the type of guy who might, I don't know, leave the gas on or something. But I don't think he's evil. I don't think he's doing it with... direct intent to harm human beings. I think he's genuinely just trying to pay off the IMF and because he thinks that's the best thing to do. But I think it's the Irish people's duty to not act from a place of fear, to get beyond the anger and act from a place of love. Don't pay it because you can't afford it. Be better than that. Be able to afford it and choose not to. You might get attacked, you might get beaten, you might get sent to prison, but either it's the right thing to do or it's the wrong thing to do. And if it's the wrong thing to do, then do not do it. Never pay it. Because you owe it to your neighbors, you owe it to yourself, you owe it to your future children, you owe it to every single human being that made love to create you today. By paying it, knowing that it's wrong, is pretty much as bad a thing you can do. Mm. That's my opinion on the matter.
Yeah, okay, well that's fair enough. Steve, you have a question there for Aidan.
Yeah, no, I want to say, first of all, yeah, I agree with what you say as regards the whole thing. Yeah. Do it. If you're going to pay it, pay it, pay it. But if you don't want to pay it for the right reasons. I mean, that's my standpoint is, and anyone who, I mean, let's be honest about it. I could probably afford to pay it. I'm not rich by any stretch of the imagination. However, I'm like looking down the road and saying, well, if we just go and we pay it, then a couple of years down the line, it's going to be privatized. The cost will increase. And then at some point in time, I'll retire and, I'll probably retire if I'm lucky enough to live that long, or I'll probably just die and it won't be my problem anymore.
Die a thirst, John. You'll die a thirst.
I'll die a thirst, yeah.
And the water will be gone.
And then my children and their children, they'll be kind of wondering, well, when all this is coming in, Dad, what were you doing? And like Alan, I mean, I don't want to be saying to them, when all that was, I didn't get involved in all that. I left it with the politicians. Should they know what they're doing? I was
watching Man City win the league.
Yeah.
Not even though.
Yeah, sorry, I don't follow football.
Yeah, either way.
But, I don't want to be saying, I was scratching me backside or I was watching X Factor. I want to be saying, well, I was trying to make a difference. I was out there with other people and I was trying to make a difference. Although, again, I see, like that video that I spoke of earlier that I seen, again, Enda Kenny, he's trying to demonise and criminalise the peaceful protesters, and there was a video up there on YouTube today, and it was there was people in one country and they were attacked. They were being attacked by the police and they were attacking back. And you could see both sides were had little victories where the police would back off, the protesters would back off, but it was equal footing, you know, well, kind of seemed like
I've
equal
seen a
footing.
Lot of that. I've seen a lot of that, yeah.
Yeah, and then it switches
to
the Irish one.
I come to violence, but you got to remember there's only 17,000 guards. So if you were to make a conscious decision to fight them, never fight, never fight will always be my answer.
Yeah.
But if you do make a decision to fight, make sure you win. Be smart about it. You know,
absolutely,
it.
Yeah. I mean,
so,
yeah.
Like, I mean, you got to make the decision before you go to a protest. If you see a pensioner, if you see a child, if you see a teenage girl, and there's a cop kneeling on her throat, punching her in the face, do you do something about that or not? And the decision needs to be made beforehand. Because if you are going to do it, you're going to take the consequences. They're not going to be going, oh, hero stops man beating woman. No, it's going to be guy hits cop. And you'll do you'll do time for it.
Yeah.
But you need to make the conscious decision beforehand and know that you will be the demon and you will not get credit for it. Yeah, maybe from the bloodied face of the girl, she might smile at you as, you know, but you forget your face. Like, it's not like you're, you know, you don't get any credit from hitting the cop.
Yeah. So don't hit him. Just,
Here, I have something, which is a bit more cheerful than, kids getting punched in the face. I have a letter to John Tierney from, that I wrote back in November about the Irish water. Do you want to hear it?
Yeah, yeah, go ahead, yeah.
It's a letter, like, it's only, I don't know if it's, like, it's not, I don't know if it's funny or not. I've never read it to anyone, so you can judge it. Dear John Tierney, I sent back your application pack because after careful consideration on whether I would like to provide you or your registered company with my personal details and PPS number, I realized that I prefer to staple my Mickey to my forehead. So please take your pack, attach it to one of your meters, and as the 60,000 protesters sang at the GPO, stick it up your hole. You referred to me as a customer. I have never been and never will be your customer. What evidence are you relying upon to make such allegations? Are you basing your allegations on hearsay? That is like me referring to you as a prostitute. Are you a prostitute, John? Isn't it true that you're willing to fuck the Irish people in exchange for money? Are you claiming that I'm liable to pay water charges even though I have no contract with you? Isn't it true that to presume such is an offence against the Criminal Justice and Fraud Offence Act 1997 and the respective Competition Act 2002? Tut tut. Isn't it true you're trying to trick people into contracting with you against their will, which is against the European Convention on Human Rights, the Constitution and contract law? So my question to you, John, is can you imagine what the Irish people would do to you in prison? Have you seen Shawshank Redemption?
Very good.
Sure, I may as well finish this. I'm nearly finished. Look, John, wake up. People have had enough and they're no longer willing to be bullied, beaten and herded like sheep. There's anger in the country. Police are using force to beat the growing crowds and it is possible there will be blood on the streets, which you are indirectly responsible for. Do you understand that the people protecting their water are protecting their right to life? For the purpose of full clarity, I will never pay your charge. I see your threats to control water as a threat on my safety, and if my water is cut off, I will hold you personally responsible. Please do the right thing for yourself and the people of Ireland. Quit your job immediately and let us create a safe, supportive environment for us all to enjoy with access to clean, healthy drinking water. Best wishes, King Aidan.
Well, that kind of says everything, really, doesn't it?
Did you get a reply?
Well, he never responded, so I just presume that he's going to do what I said, yeah?
Well, that's the way it goes. If he doesn't respond within a timely, you know, 10-day period, he's accepted your letter.
He's accepted as full fact, yeah. Silence is acquiescence, good man.
There you go.
That's it. Well, that's the way it works, isn't it? That is the way it works. Now, tell me, you have a book you're bringing out. And I don't think you mentioned it the last time you were on the show. Tell us about your book, and I'm sure you have a few stories.
I'd say the last time I was writing the book, but not really consciously, in the sense that I've written a lot of letters, I've beaten a lot of companies, or I've had correspondence with companies, AIB, Bank of Ireland, banks abroad, debt collectors, eFlow, Meteor, loads of debt collectors from England, Ireland, all over, VHI, eFlow, mention them. And all of these I've put together, all of my letters, because I've beaten a lot of these companies through will, through knowledge, and through humour. A lot of times I've had a lot of fun with them. I've even met some of the debt collectors and become friends with them. So a lot of people said to me, Aidan, I need to read these letters, because the hardest letter is the very first one you send.
Yeah.
Because okay. It's like the first time you stand up to your parents, or the first time you stand up to a teacher. It's like the first time you stand up for yourself. And that's a terrifying thing, because you've been told your whole life not to do it. But once you get through that, then you can start to, you know, have less and less fear. And for me, like, I deal with most of my letters now is in, I just make them funny, right? I make, obviously they have to be legal and correct, but a lot of the letters that I've written are fucking hilarious to banks and stuff.
Okay.
I'll get one for you.
Yeah, go on, get one and give us a sample of it.
All right, let me see. I got the VHI to pay 20 grand that they said they wouldn't pay.
What, to you?
Yeah, basically. I mean, the long story is, hang on, let me, those letters, let me just see. I'll pick a random one. Okay, hang on a second. Dear Jackie Kins, who's that one? Chapter 2. Oh, wait, okay, I'll tell that story quickly. Okay, which one do you want to hear? VHI.
Yeah,
so my uncle had a heart attack and they said they weren't going to cover it. I wrote about like 100 different emails to them back and forth and I won. But it took a lot of work. It took a lot of persistence. But the thing about it is I stood by the truth. That's all I ever did. Yeah. The truth is they are responsible. I know they said they have a policy and they said they had blah, blah, blah. But I was the witness. I was there. I could document it. I could verify it. I got doctors to write something and sign it because it was the truth. They were basing it on some hearsay, basically, you know, their opinion based on some professionals that were in a different country. Now, that's an interesting idea, right? Because most people would back down because they'd go, well, these guys have got lawyers. They've got solicitors. And if you come from the place of, I won't back down because it's the truth. Here's my theory on it, right, dealing with this, and this is one of the things in the book. It's a bit Jesus-ish now, so bear with me. Turn an enemy into a friend, right? First they will mock you, and this is the same with all protests as well. This is the Irish protesters. First they'll mock you, they'll ridicule you, they'll laugh at you, they'll go, no way, they're not even going to turn up, they're, you know, you're nothing. You don't know, we've got solicitors and lawyers, you're a nobody. But then, eventually, if you stick to your guns and you hold it and you're right and you just keep sticking with truth, they will begrudgingly admit there may be some truth in what you say. That's phase two. And if you can get them to there, they've already shown weakness, right? They've already showed that there's a possibility you might be right and you don't bleed in the shark tank. If you were a barrister, you'd fuck them up for showing weakness, right? But your aim is not to fuck them up. Your aim is to continually show them the truth until they see it. So in the third phase, you'll get them to a place where they go, oh my God, they realize you're right. You've been right all the time. And now you can follow up with potentially criminal charges. This isn't like a civil thing anymore. You can take them, you can take their body, get it sent to prison. You can take their shit from them, you know, but possibly. But you're not doing it to attack anybody. You never were. You were simply highlighting the truth. And when they see that, eventually they'll pay you what you're owed and they'll love you for it and they start to work for you and they become your friend. And that's what happened with the VHI. So eventually, you know, they wouldn't pay me. They were telling me go to the ombudsman or the complaints department, which is clearly a dumb thing to do because they're never going to take your side. So they paid me all the money, and my uncle's life was saved. And then eventually, my uncle's like, "Oh, how did you do that?" And so on. I said they'd pay for anything. So I followed up with my flight cost €1,000. And the cost of the trauma that you've caused to my family remains, as of yet, unbilled. So they rang me up, told me, the women in the office said, listen, we'd like to pay for your flight, and if we were ever sick, we'd like you to represent us. Yeah, and
that's
then they
brilliant.
Paid for my phone bill as well. But, I mean, we could have sued them for, like, thousands, 50 grand or something, but the point is, my uncle has never sued anybody. He didn't want to sue anybody. He just wanted, you know, fair payment.
Yeah, yeah. Which is fair enough, and maybe that's what they seen. Maybe that was the game. See, that's the game a lot of these companies play. They know they're in the wrong, but if you just... a lot of people will stop at the first hurdle and then leave it at that. But if you're persistent, then they go, oh, well, oh, okay, this guy's he's not going to go away, or she's not going to go away, so we're going to have to come up with some kind of compromise that they're both happy with. And but you said you had another one there.
I had... Do you want to hear about me to your phone bill, or do you want to hear about a letter from... I was looking for a letter from a bank... Or our TV license, we got them as well.
Let's have the TV license for a bit of fun.
Okay, we go to the chapter on the TV license. I'm obviously not going to read the chapter, but I'll just give you the quick summary. Some bullshit letter came here to the occupant looking for, I don't know, do I have a TV license or not. For you guys, I'll tell you, because you're my friends.
Good.
I don't have a TV, right? I have no interest in watching TV. I find most of it propaganda, annoying, irritating. Most of the stuff on TV, especially the ads, bothers me, so I choose not to have one. However, I also don't have to tell you that. That's my business, right? I chose to tell you that because we're friends, right?
Okay.
So if some random person who's from the post office or from some department, TV license records office, sends me a letter claiming, you know, asking me if I have a TV or not, I'm not going to tell them. It's none of their business, right?
Right.
That's the way I see it. What did I write back? Okay, here's my response. This is the first time I've ever read this to anyone, so you give me your opinion at the end of this.
Okay.
Hi, Jay Brady. That's the person who wrote to me. Thanks for informing me that a TV license inspector called to my address. For the record, I do not consent to any inspectors calling to my address without prior written consent, unless it is Inspector Gadget or Inspector Morse. If you can confirm it was one of these inspectors, please disregard the rest of this letter. Otherwise, I demand that you answer all of my questions within 7 days, or I'll be very disappointed in you, to say the least. One, I've only got 3 questions. One, if I don't let you into my property, which I won't, how can you prove that I have a television? Two, you signed the letter as J. Brady. What does the J stand for? I bet it is John. Is that short for Jonathan, or were you named after a man's bathroom? Three, I noticed that you take payments in Laser, Visa, and MasterCard. Do you also take payments and go fuck yourselves? If so, how many would you like? Furthermore, Johnny, I'm not going to tell you if I have a television or not, and I challenge you to find out. I will agree to inform you that I've never paid a license, and it's highly unlikely I ever will, because in short, RTE sucks. However, I may reconsider if you convince RTE to make a reality TV show where TV license inspectors have to fight the water meter installers to the death.
That is
fucking funny. Until then, remember, no matter how many people you've annoyed with your silly letters, there's still time for you to forgive yourself. I forgive you. King Aiden. P.S. Please find and close full and final payment of one go fuck yourself. And then I actually cut a bit of paper out which said one go fuck yourself on it, and shaped it like a 50p. And sent it to him. But then, right, he never sent it back to me. He started sending me more legal shit, right? So then I followed up, and I won't read the full thing, but I basically looked for my money back. Remember the bit of paper I sent?
Yeah.
Him? Yeah. Well, it's mine. I wanted it back. So I claimed it was worth 160 euros in his monetary value, right? Because money's just money, right? We use currency as a form of payment, but it's not actually backed by anything, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's not backed by gold or anything. So I can issue my own currency, right? You know, I have a beautiful friend, Emily. Right? Let's say I said, listen, I will give you a piece of paper, you know, in exchange, like a voucher. You can create vouchers. Like it says, let's say she was to give me a massage. I was to give her, okay, she was to give me a massage. I could give her a voucher for one. So I can't do today because my fingers are sore because I was, baking too many Christmas puddings. But I'll give you one next week. And that voucher that I give her, one massage voucher, that's a form of payment, right?
Yeah. It's a promissory note, isn't it? It's a promise to pay.
So we need to realize that.
Yeah.
So, but no, I'm sticking to my point here, right? This guy has my money. And now I've made a claim that it's worth 160 euros, and he's not rebutted that. He's not said it's not worth 160 euros, and he can't. How the fuck can he? It's up to me to issue the amount of my bit of paper's worth 160 euros, and he can't prove it's not. And he still has it. So that fucker's actually stolen my money. Now, I forgive him, but he actually does owe me money.
Okay, just some weird logic in that, but yeah, we know where you're coming from.
Okay, look, let's put it this way, right? If I sent him a diamond... Okay, if I send him a diamond worth 5 grand,
yeah,
all right, and he kept that diamond,
yeah,
he's not allowed to do that. He's a breach. If he kept it for himself and sold it for himself, he's in breach of contract, breach of duty, and we could sue him and he could lose his job, right? Because he wouldn't be allowed to do that.
Yeah.
Now, if he took the diamond and rang me back and said, "We can't take your diamond as payment. We have to give it back to you."
Yeah.
Because that would be his duty to do so under his insurance and so on. That's what he needs to do.
Yeah.
Now, my bit of paper, you might laugh at it and say it's not worth money, but I went to the trouble of making that.
Oh, no, to you, it's if you deem it as a value as 160, then it's value to you.
It is, you're right, it is value to me, exactly. Yeah. And he refused to return it, or he lost it, he misplaced it. Again, breach of duty. And if he proves gross incompetence by losing my valuable property, well, then he needs to be held accountable for it in the court of law. Now, I'm not going to take him to court, but if he tried to take me to court, I could insist and get my payment, and I would. but he didn't want to play anymore after a few more letters. They always give up after a few more letters anyway. I actually sometimes try and drag them out longer because they... You know what? That's the thing. It's actually too fucking easy. It's the same with eFlow, all of them. They won't really go all the way. I mean, they'll pick on some middle-aged woman with a family who's, you know, on the dole and just barely got enough to survive. She's already weak and broken, right? They'll pick on her and they'll give her some jail time for 5 days so she'll tell all her friends and they'll put it on radio. Joe Duffy will go, oh, that's terrible, you're in jail, and the rest of the country will be scared. Because they're using fear as a tactic. They're using fear as a tool. If you can get someone in fear, then they're going to do whatever. I mean, people will be your slave. Make them feel fear and they'll do whatever you want.
Yeah.
But they can't. They're not going to deal with me because I'll drag it through the courts. They know that I'm using legal words. They know that I'll win. One, I'll probably win. But even if I don't win, I'll still win indirectly by spending so much of their time, so much of their... I will cost them as much as possible. Worst case scenario, what? I get a few days in jail. Big deal. Whatever. I'll meditate.
Yeah, yeah. No, I totally agree. And I think there's a lot of people now waking up and saying that with Irish water and saying, sod it, look... You know, 3 meals a day, and you can have Sky TV or whatever in jail, you know, and people are just...
back to the TV again.
You know, back to the TV again, and you can have as much sex as you want, apparently. although it's not sex of your choice. But, no, people are actually turning around and saying, you know, that's it, I'm not paying, we can't... I mean, literally, people are don't have the money. I know Steve said, you know, maybe you could push it and actually afford it. Well, I'm saying I can't. End of story. So, you know, and that's the way I see it.
Let's just say you had €1 million, right? I gave you €1 million of my currency and you cashed it in the bank. For some reason, realized the Aidan Killian go fuck yourself true value and gave you €1 million. And now you got €1 million. Would you pay it?
Out of principle, I wouldn't.
Yeah, see, but I'm not basing this on, I have enough money to pay it, but there's no way I'll pay it. There's no way I'm going to pay for water that's already been paid for.
Yeah.
It's been paid for, like.
Exactly.
We're the only country with... I mean, the concept of putting a meter on people.
Well, Aidan,
it's ridiculous.
I don't know whether you heard what I said at the start of the show, but Michael Tellinger has brought a video regarding promissory notes. And it was a brilliant 25-minute video. We'll try and send the link over to you. Mm. And for you, you'd be very interested in this, right? Because you being an ex-banker and all that, you know, being in the banking service. And he basically said that the banks haven't touched him in a year and a half. He's used this because it's all, you know yourself, banking is all about accounting. And he got the promissory note, did all the bits and pieces that he needed to get it signed up, sent it off to them. Their balance sheet is now corrected and happy days. The bank are happy. End of story. Now, he did say that you only use promissory notes.
So let me get this right. Did he issue his own money? His
yes.
His own promise to pay?
Yes.
All right. So, yeah, that can be done, but you need to be very careful. You need the Bill of Exchange Act. I've never done it, so I wouldn't recommend it, because they'll do you for fraud if they can. But if you know the law, yeah, you can. You're right. Spot on. You can actually pay off whatever you want by issuing your own currency, according to the law.
Well, he did, and he did it according to the law and the Bill of Exchange Act. He did it exactly by the book.
Who is he? I'm going to look into this guy.
Michael Tellinger.
I'll get the link.
I'll send it.
I know someone
send
else.
To
I can't say his name because he wouldn't like me saying it on the radio. But I know someone who's done it twice successfully, and one of them was for a mortgage. So
over here.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is the thing. Steve's going to send you over the link. You're going to like this because Michael's been on our show. He was on our show last year. I think he was on PIR with Sean McGuire there not so long ago, and he has been through the courts and the banks, and they took his house off. And he's literally been through all of that stuff, right? So he's been through, they put him through the ringer, and he came out the other end, and he did all his research. And this is all the information that he's gleaned from promissory notes and the Bill of Exchange, and he shows you how to do it and the format and where to get it and what to do and who has to stamp what, so it's all legal and above board. And he said, I've done it, he said, and I've signed off, he signed off something like 800,000 rand, which is obviously the African currency. And he said they haven't come near him for a year and a half.
Well, there you go. There you go. I mean, yeah, that's impressive. I haven't done that now. I lost with the banks when I took them on the mortgage, eventually. Yeah. I mean, I delayed them for a long time by trying to get contracts from them. But they're, the promissory note from the other point of view, I wanted to see. Actually, I have a joke. Will I tell you a joke?
Go on.
I have a joke that's related to this. But it's kind of what really happened rather than a joke. So, first of all, I believe in debt forgiveness, by the way. So I wrote to the bank and I wanted to get them. I wanted a signed contract from these guys. When I started looking into this, I realized there's so much fraud, so much corruption. I wanted to see a signed contract. And they never sent me a signed contract. And I wondered why. And I thought it had something to do with instead, they wrote me some letter and at the top it said, without prejudice. I didn't know what that meant, so I looked it up. It means cannot be used in a court of law. So I wrote back my own letter at the top, with prejudice.
Very good.
You must produce these documents on time and on demand, and if you fail to do so, there is no debt. Love and respect to all human beings, Aiden. And they never produce the contracts or the signed invoice, and I thought it had something to do with derivatives. They make it sound complicated, but it's simple. You get thousands of mortgages, you put it in one deal, and you sell it. So if you've sold it, right, they don't have it anymore. So how can they produce something they don't have? And then I realized it's worse than that. There never even was a proper contract. What there was is a promissory note, a promise to pay. So basically, my signature was used as an asset to create the money that the bank never had. Let's go back. My signature created the money that the bank never had, and behind my back with derivatives, they profited. So if you think about it, those fuckers actually owe me money.
Yeah, totally.
But I believe in debt forgiveness, so I let them off.
Brilliant. There you go. Well, I'll tell you, you'll enjoy this video because he actually tells you how to do it and where to download the promissory note and just one or two little changes you have to make for your country. So it's something that I'll probably be speaking to.
Here's my quick opinion on that. I'm going to look into it and I'll be fascinated by it. But I'd say if you do that, you'll get done for fraud. And most people don't have the strength yet to... they do have the strength, but they haven't got the experience or the knowledge to be able to deal with that. So if it was me and I was to do it, I'd make sure it wasn't fraud. So I'd start with something very, very small. For example, pay your car tax with it. Pay your car tax for a month and they'll send guards to your house. And they will. But you can turn around and go, what's the problem? I want to see the original check. And when you ask for the original check, they probably won't be able to produce that. And that will be your way of knowing that you're okay. But if you can't stand up to them, don't go trying to pay a mortgage off with something that you're issuing for the first time.
Yeah.
It's not that simple. Otherwise, everyone will do it, right? So just tread carefully is what I'm saying.
Well, when Michael was talking about it, I totally agree. It's not that simple. But maybe because of people doing it the wrong way is because it wasn't working. But based on, I haven't tried it myself, but based on what Michael is saying, he looks like he's, all the stamps he's got from the local police station, from the law office, everything is being stamped and approved and accepted. And he's obviously doing that on for reasons to say, well, look, there you go. They've accepted it by stamping it and they've approved it. And the local police station, they've stamped it and they've witnessed the signatures and everything else. So he's doing everything by the book.
Well, I love his transparency and his, sharing with everybody. It sounds great. I'm looking forward to reading that. That's the type of thing now I'd enjoy.
Yeah, well, no, it's not. It's a YouTube video. Just sit back, kick back and watch
better.
It. Even better, you know.
Sit back and enjoy the ride. Did you send it to me there? You sent it to me there. I got a link. Great.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So, we'll be letting you go shortly. You can have your cup of tea and you can sit down and watch that. So, your book. What's the story with your book? When is it out? Where can people get it? And what's it all about?
The book is called Dear Plonker. It's all about a collection of all my letters, and I explain what I'm doing and why I win each time. So if you've got issues with VHI or a bank or a mortgage, not a mortgage, probably more like a credit card debt, realistically. Well, you can use it with a mortgage too, why not? Whatever, any of these companies, media or a phone company, if anybody sent a debt collector, all my stuff in there is funny, so it's easy to read. But it also explains, you know, why a lot of the time you don't have to take that shit from them and you can beat them without getting stressed.
Yeah. And I think the one great thing that's, and it sounds great, I look forward to it when you bring it
out. Oh, yeah, where do you get it? Hang on. Dear Plonker, where can you get it?
Yeah.
You can actually buy pre-order copies with the Common Law Society. They're publishing it for me. The Common Law Society are publishing it. So
excellent.
Go
okay.
onto their website, maybe. That's probably the best thing.
Yeah, no, that's cool because I look forward to having a read of that because that's going to be funny and interesting and educational, Steve.
Aiden, what about the DVD?
DVD should be out ages ago. Jesus versus Buddha, I'd say another 2 weeks. I'm really excited about this show because it's the most... it's really beautiful. I've taken my comedy to a different level. Like, it's really... It's quite a powerful show. It's about an hour and 15 minutes. And... there's so much in it. Like when I look at bits of the show, I mean, I don't know how I created that, you know. So it was more powerful than I've ever seen comedy before. So my next show, I'm going to working on a new show starting in January to work on a brand new show, but it won't be about, you know, the last one is Jesus and Buddha, so you've got material to really access inner beauty, compassion and love, and I did that through comedy, which I was very proud of.
And do you like doing observational comedy as well?
I don't really observe anything, man. I just take a story that I want to share with the world, and then I make it funny. Like if with the Irish water, there's a few bits on the internet about that I did. I just took it, sat down and wrote it. So usually there's an experience in my life, like dealing with the banks, or, you know, somebody crashing into my car, or like a policeman arresting me because I won't give him his name. And then I just tell the story as it happened, and then I make it funny. So for me, I base it all on truth.
Yeah. Do you want to tell people, the listeners, we have a few minutes, do you want to tell listeners about the story about your wheel clamp and what that story was about the police coming up and interfering with your what you were doing?
Yeah, sure. There was a clamp on my car, and obviously I could have paid for it with my credit card that I'm never going to pay back anyway, or I could have used an angle grinder. So I get the angle grinder, and this is on the Liffey, right? But there was sparks going everywhere. It takes like 2 minutes. Nearly had it off when these blue flashing lights came. But I kept going, right? Because my mum says if you start something, you should finish it. And a cop, I presume he was a cop, a man acting as a cop, said, "Are you all right there?" Yeah, I'm grand. I nearly have it off now, thanks. So I was just having the crack. But he then asked me for my name. And I had a choice. I could have given my name or not. But it occurred to me that I'm not doing anything wrong here. So why should I give this man my name? Now, obviously I don't want to start a fight with a man dressed in a cop because he's got a baton and I'd probably be too afraid to hit him, right? But at the same time, I don't want to comply, right? So he said, "What's your name? Under what law do I have to tell you my name? Under Provision Act, blah, blah, blah." Hang on a sec. Did you say act of law? Are you claiming that an act is the law? Is the law? You were to do so as a fraudulent offence. What's your name? I don't have to tell you my name, but then show me ID. So I pointed at my face and I said, "Here you go. I needed to see ID with a photograph." Why do you need a photograph when you have the real thing? Just tell me who you are. What's your name? John. Now tell me who you are. Okay, John, you can call me Aiden. Aiden what? Ah, Jesus, John. We're on first name terms at this stage. And he eventually fucking arrests me, and we go back to the station. He robbed my wallet, and when he takes my wallet out, without my consent, by the way, I made it very clear that I don't consent to being touched, raped, murdered, interfered with, or kidnapped. But they kidnapped me and stole my wallet. When he took the credit card out of the wallet, he pointed at the name Aiden Killian and said, "Is that you?" To which I responded, "Don't be ridiculous. That's a piece of plastic." But he took the name into Google, or police Google, Plugle, and I suppose he thought he knew who I was, which is interesting because I don't even fully know who I am. So I don't know how the fuck he thought he knew who I was. And he asked me other questions like my date of birth, and I said I didn't remember. I was too young. And he asked me where I live, and I said I live wherever I am. And he said, "You know what I mean, where are you staying tonight?" And I pointed in the cell, and I said, "Probably in there." and I did. And you know the interesting things? I stayed there for a few hours, and I overcame the fear because I was scared at the start. And then I realized it doesn't make a difference whether I'm in a cell or in a palace. If I'm meditating, my eyes are closed. Mm. And most of the happiest experience I've had in this thing they call life was with my eyes closed.
Yeah.
So I just sat there and still and just observed the fear, and it kind of disappeared. And then I even started finding it quite amusing after a while. I'm not like a madman laughing to myself running around the cell, just sitting there kind of with a content smile on my face. And time passed, maybe 2, 3, 4 hours, I don't know. And he came in, and he wasn't a dick at all. He was actually okay. I mean, as far as, you know, people, you know, picking you up and taking you to a cell and stealing your wallet, he was kind of, he wasn't condescending, he wasn't aggressive, he wasn't violent. And then he let me go. He was even so nice, he invited me back to see him again, or as he liked to call it, a summons.
Okay. Right, okay.
So that was it. I obviously never went back, and that was it. That was the end of the story. My understanding is if somebody leaves an object on top of my property, it's mine, or I can remove it. So I don't want his clamp, but I'm entitled to take it off. And that's the deal that I have with him. And I don't see anything wrong with that. Now, other people say you've got to be careful where you park, but I'm very aware and I'm very sensitive about other humans around me. And I wouldn't go parking like in a handicapped place. I wouldn't block a fire brigade. It was like 1 a.m. along the quays. There was millions of places there. I wasn't blocking anyone. So that argument is null and void and factually incorrect. So that's it. That's all I have. Do you want me to read a letter? What are you doing? What do you want from me, Stephen Al? What's going on?
Well, what happened after that? I mean, so did you go back and cut the clamp off, or what was the end result?
Oh yeah, well it was actually my mate was there, and by the time I get back, he'd already paid and taken the car home.
So
that was it. Yeah. Well, I took it, yeah.
Summons. What happened to summons?
I don't know. I didn't really. I didn't do anything with it. Nothing ever happened. I never got a letter in the post or anything. I don't know what happened actually. because I signed the form. You know the form. I wouldn't sign the form. I wouldn't tell them my name. I wouldn't say I am Aiden and all that.
Yeah.
All that free man madness. But it wasn't that. I wasn't really being free. And anyway, what's a free man? I'm not a non-free man. I'm not an unfree man. I don't know. I'm just me, right? I'm just me, and if someone's asking me my name, I'm going to tell them if I feel like it. But if I feel that they're going to use my name against me, and he does say everything you say can and will be used against you. So I'm not going to give him any information that he can use against me, you know? So I prefer not to sign anything, because I only want to sign something that I fully understand. So if he takes out a big long contract or whatever he calls it, piece of paper, that's a bond or whatever he wants to call it, and he asks me to sign it, obviously I'm not going to sign it. I mean, it would seem insane for me to sign something that can be used against me in a court of law. So I just say, listen, I can't comply with any of this because I don't understand it politely. And they... Basically, and I said I'd only talk to the sergeant as well. And the sergeant, whoever the head of the thing was, he was kind of reasonable. He said, look, if you sign it, you can go home tonight. Otherwise, you're going to have to go to court tomorrow. And I was like, for what? What are you talking about? Have I broken the law? And he's like, well, you can't go around taking clamps off. And I go, well, I could if you weren't there disturbing my peace. And it's, you know, belongs to a company. So they can write me a letter and I can deal with it in the court. But you're kind of stopping me. And he was kind of half listening, but at the same time he just wanted to go, he just wanted it over with, like it wasn't a big enough deal for him, I suppose. So what happened in the end, what happened was I signed it that I could go home, but the way I signed it was under threat and duress by, you know, Aiden, Killian, duly authorised representative, taking up loads of room and making it really obvious. So for me, this is basically, I'm signing it under threat and duress, the threat of, you know, being sent to prison, the duress, the stress of being kidnapped, you know, surrounded by violent people, uncomfortable. So it means the whole thing's null and void, because a contract's not a contract if you're under threat and duress.
Yeah.
So probably his summons didn't mean anything because they didn't have any proper arrest or anything on me, you know.
And that story now that you've just told us, would that be kind of typical of what you would, a typical gag or story that you would tell now on stage?
I do that piece on stage. I mean, you've got a longer version, but you just get the funny bits on them. You know, a lot of it's fucking real. It's all real. Yeah. He asked me my name and I wouldn't tell him, and I was, you know, I wouldn't give him, you know, my date of birth or all that. That stuff was all just deadly real, like, for me. Like, he was even laughing a bit. Like, what happened when it happened? Like, a load of people stood around me. It's in the Jesus versus Buddha show. There's a bit of that in it. Or Take the Red Pill is free online if you want to see a video of me. That's like an old one. It's 4 years old, but it's free online, and people seem to like it. So Take the Red Pill, Aiden Killian on YouTube. That's free. I'm going to have a new DVD, which will be on my site in 2 weeks, and my book should be out. It's taking pre-orders now on the Common Law Society site, and that's going to be deadly. I can't wait till people read this book. It's really going to help waken people up, because you hit them through laughter. When people laugh, they release endorphins. So it's like you're dealing with very stressful shit for people, but through a funny way. So I'm excited about that.
You probably even have a read of it yourself, will you?
Yeah, sometimes when I read over, like, there's a letter here in front of me that I wrote June 2013, which is just a year and a half ago. Like, you were talking about the banks coming after you. For me, they gave up a long time ago, but you get a letter once a year kind of thing. They just send it, like, like a copy-paste-enter thing, but it's not even signed by a human being. It's just a template. So I got this one from a matter. I got a letter looking for money when I came back. I was away for a while because I was dealing with my uncle when he was sick. When I came back, I had a letter from a guy called Rob, you know, saying that I owed money and blah blah blah. So do you want to hear my response?
Yeah.
We got a few minutes. Go ahead.
It's a love letter. Dear Rob, I received your first letter dated February 21. I ignored it because I was busy having trouble with a beautiful Russian woman called Polina. She did the old let's just be friends thing, which really hurt my ego. She ended up with a footballer instead of me, and I can't stand football. Talk about adding salt to the wound, eh? She has this innocent, vulnerable look like a wounded little puppy, and I just want to hold her till she sleeps in my arms, and then when she wakes, I want to dedicate my day to making her laugh. Anyway, I suppose you're more interested in your letters. I'm not sure I fully understand what you're on about. I believe you want me to give you some money because you think I owe AIB money. Obviously, the CEO did not show you the letter I sent firing AIB for gross incompetence. I informed you that I'd not consider working with your bank until you've apologized to the people of this country after paying back your debt in full. I'm still waiting for this to happen. The truth of the matter is that your banking, your industry as a whole, works against the good of humanity, and you are not only taking part in what I'd call financial terrorism. I really love people, especially Polina, and if you could only give, if I could only give you the knowledge and love that I've accumulated, you'd understand that sending me letters with letter of demand on it really is super silly. I rebut everything you wrote, especially about people coming to my home. If I was not so in love, I could even perceive that as a threat that you have signed. I do not consent to anything you've written, and if you look into this, you'll see that I'm 100% right, and you, my friend, are being a bit of a nincompoop. However, if you give me advice that makes Polina fall in love with me within 7 days of receipt of this letter, I will pay off the alleged debt in full. Peace out, brother. Aiden.
Very good. Aiden, we're going to have to leave it there. But listen, thanks a lot for coming on the show. Brilliant information. We hope you have a great Christmas. Good luck with the DVD and the book. Steve, if you want to get Aiden to get all the details off him there.
Well,
Happy New Year, Happy Christmas, be well, my friends.
Happy Hanukkah. Yeah, no, I actually have all your details here. Well, I haven't got all your details, but we have the website, and is there anything else besides the website? Do you have a YouTube channel?
Yeah, I'm on YouTube. Actually, I'm the third most popular Irish comedian on YouTube, so...
There's only three Irish comedians, though, isn't there? Yeah, but who's number one?
Tommy Tiernan, of course, and then there's Bishop.
No, you're much better than them.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, I don't know about that. Okay, I'll take it. I accept.
I accept it. Okay.
Well, let's put it this way. You're talking about stuff and you're making people laugh, but you're giving them information at the same time. You're educating them.
That's why you're number one, because it's not just about the jokes. You're actually educating at the same time.
Oh, stop it, guys. You're rubbing my belly here.
Okay, Aiden, stay with us there for a minute. We're going to go off to a musical break. Thanks again for coming on. And Steve, are we going to play your fantastic tune again?
Absolutely.
Right, okay. Rocking Around the Christmas Tree, OAM styley. Here we go.
This is Open Your Mind Radio on OYMRadio.com, UnitedWeStrike.com, and PeoplesInternetRadio.com.
We're back. Yes, we are. That was our little rendition of a famous Christmas song. Your voice reminds me of a spanner. That's a very unkind thing to say. Anyway, yeah, spanners are very useful, by the way. They're a great tool. Yeah, anyway, rocking around the Christmas tree, OYM Biggie style.
Excellent. Yeah. Okay, right, our next guest on is Finbar Markey, who's one of the members of the Land League, the County Louth Land League. And I've been kind of doing a little bit of helping out in the background, along with so many other people, trying to stop people from being evicted from their homes. And Finbar has been a sterling contributor to the Land League and doing a fantastic job. And what we're going to try and do is, you know, maybe once a week, if not maybe every second week, it depends on what information is available, is have a little bit of information at the end of the show regarding how the Land League, or maybe it's the Hub, or, you know, because they're doing the same thing. We're all trying to do our bit to help people. And just give out an update on what's going on with the Land League and what's happening around the country, because it's getting to develop into such a momentum. There's branches of the Land League being set up in all parts of the country at the moment. So we'll bring Finbar in. He's going to be able to give us an update on what's going on there. But we'll find out from there. Good evening, Finbar. How are you?
Hey, Alan, what's the crack with you?
Yeah, not too bad, not too bad. Listen, brilliant launch on a Wednesday, I have to say. Excellent information, a good turnout. Good speakers up there talking about what's going on and exposing things that are going on. And, you know, basically all ahead full steam, really.
Yeah, Wednesday night we had the launch of the Meath Land League, and it was just another milestone on a rolling launch program, really, throughout the country in all of the counties that's happening over the next few months. So we had Meath. There on the 3rd of December, we had a launch in Mayo in which the halls were packed. People were cheering in from the doorways, and it was a very uplifting and almost a spiritual, well, if not a spiritual experience in itself, which is what's needed as well, I think, to unify us. We will be having an official, although the Louth model has been running longest, it hasn't officially been launched. So we will have a launch of that in mid-January, Westmeath at the end of January, and then we're looking into Monaghan and Galway and other areas after that. So we are hoping that by the 1st of May, every county will have a branch that is very real and very tangible. So it will have a membership enough to form a committee. It will have a location such as offices. There will be drop-in clinics. There will be workshops. But there will also, and I think it's very important in terms of the strategy that has emerged, to understand that we're not just dealing with administrative things. We're not just trying to neutralize the courts. We're neutralizing the courts so that we can agitate and get the time to agitate for change outside. And so we're not claiming to be either wishy-washy or militant. I suppose we have to be, at this stage, both. Because one of the biggest pieces of news, I think, since probably the famine, was announced last week in the shadow of the big protest, or 2 weeks ago in the shadow of the big protests. And that was that 50,000 homes are in the courts at the moment for repossession, or possession, orders of possession, as they're called. And that there's another 50,000 homes after that. Now, there's a family at the end of every one of those homes. And if we were to do some very basic statistical equations and multiply the number of homes by 3.5, and some Irish families have more than that and some less, but 3.5, we're looking at 500,000 people facing the road. Now, that is just biblical in proportion. And so we are escalating our rollout across the country. And you're very right to say that over the last few months, things have really taken off. But that is what we face today. And so we don't have the time to enter into years of negotiation. We need to show might as well as wisdom in how we move forward. And I think it's really happening around the country, and people are latching on to the Land League.
And can I just say that for people who are, you know, they might feel that you want to try and contribute or help out in some way. I mean, what do you suggest? That they just, you know, form a local group or go to a local group, and the local group will help them and educate them on what needs to be done. I mean, I really know very little in what needs to be done, but, you know, from a, just, you know, going to Trim Court and seeing what the other people were doing, I just followed them and yourself, you know, and what you've been saying in the meetings. And just telling people to look, you know, don't be caught out, you know, get an adjournment and contact the Land League. I mean, that's basically it for starters, really, until you start getting more knowledge.
Yeah, it is. There's a big part, education plays a big part in this. We don't expect, and we know that it's unattractive for many, for people to protest. Some people don't like the idea of that. And we don't want a situation where we have to stand in family gardens holding off sheriffs. There is always an opportunity prior to that to press a pause button and to get things happening through paperwork again. So at a minimum, if you can make a cup of tea for somebody, if you can give somebody a hug, or if you can smile, and then other skills come into play, such as, would you be able to learn how to write a letter? Would you be able to pick it out of a folder of template letters, pick out the one most appropriate for someone's situation? Things like that. But the very, very first thing that we would hope people would be able to bring is a sense of humanity back to people who are being dehumanized at the moment. I've seen in people's eyes, I've seen in the sicknesses that people have when they come into our clinics. I've seen in the shaking, in the inability to get eye contact at the beginning. I've seen a dehumanizing of people who are in arrears. And I really mean that. This is not an exaggeration. And so to be able to alleviate their immediate fears by just highlighting that if you decide to come along with us and stand up with us, you will be in your home for years, because we will neutralize the courts. Just by, not through protest, but just by getting you to stand up and get your rights. So, for instance, instead of having a situation where an order is made by a registrar, just insisting that you want to defend yourself. If you do that alone, you're going to be in your home for a few years. Just that alone. But we will help you to do that. But in the meantime, as I say, there are other characteristics that we appreciate too. We appreciate people who are willing to go and protest, to go out onto the front line and to highlight this issue. 500,000 people, and it's not mentioned on the news or in any newspapers. And the only place that you'll get it is radio stations like Open Your Mind Radio and other radio stations. You won't get it anywhere else. But 500,000 people, we don't have the time. We know that we are fishing for men and women at the moment. We know that it's hard to get people to step over that personal boundary to become somebody who believes that you have something to give to changing Ireland. But more and more, as people realise there's no white knight coming over the hill, more and more people are getting involved. So at some stage, it's likely that you, the listener, are going to get involved. So instead of waiting and wasting that time, we're asking people to get involved now. And we believe, like the Land League of the 1880s, that we will sort this out within 2 or 3 years.
Yeah, definitely. And if the listeners want to get involved and they have a couple of hours just to spare, contact the local branch in their county.
You'll get it on Facebook or you'll get it somewhere like that, you know.
And then join them and just help out. And I will say that, you know, there is a really a great buzz with the teamwork, the camaraderie, and being service to others, actually helping people and seeing. I mean, on a Wednesday night, the couple that myself and let's say inverted commas Mary's going to be on the show next week, that we spoke to, they were going up in, they were in Trim Court, and they didn't know, we just said, are you up here for repossession? They said, yes, we don't know whether the judge is going to take our house off us today, we probably will. So first of all, they didn't know anything because they were up in front of a registrar, not a judge, and because it was their first time, it was going to get adjourned anyway, but they didn't know that. And the chap hadn't slept for 3 nights. He was just, him and his wife were just really stressed. So when they came out, you could see the stress leave them. But they were there, they contacted you and they were complimenting how brilliant you are and how you were helping them. And they were there on Wednesday night. And you could see the smile on their face and they were relaxed and they were laughing and they were jolly. And
possibly for the first time in a few years.
In a few years. And it was, that's brilliant to see. And if you're, so if the listeners are out there and they want to be a part of this, well, join the local Land League, even if it's only for a few hours. Join it, learn the law, because it could be you. It could be you, like the bloody lotto. It could be you, but not in a bad way. But it could be any of us. You know, we're only one paycheck away from being evicted, you know, or having problems with our
but
mortgage.
But even beyond that, you know, we're not just looking for people to come on board who are in trouble, because that's not going to win this. The amount of people at the moment that are holding on by their fingernails, that are just about scraping by the full mortgage payment, and those people are suffering also on a daily basis. There's small and medium businesses out there who have no money coming into their tills because every red cent is going to the banks, whether it's our tax or whether it's our mortgage payments. It's all going out to foreign investment houses. That's where our money is going. And the country will not pick up, despite the lies and the manipulation of government figures. The country is not going to pick up economically unless we start redirecting this country. And that's what the Land League is about, because it is about more than just preventing the immediate eviction. It's about actually redirecting the nation and giving it a sense of pride. And that's why we are harking back to the 1880s quite a bit, because the problematic hasn't really changed and the solution hasn't really changed. And if we can just be as brave and yet as humble as our forefathers were, did this with no money in their pockets, I think within the 3 years we'll do achieve what they achieved.
And they did it without communication and social media. So we have the tools now. Something I said earlier on the show, you probably didn't pick it up, Finbar, because I know you're probably on the road, was that on Wednesday night I was kind of very surprised that people were talking about all forms of communication like Facebook and websites, but nothing was mentioned regarding the alternative radio, the media. And as you know, Wednesday I stood up and I did a quick talk to actually present people, you know, in the radio side, because there are radio stations out there like OIM, like People's Internet Radio and others, who are trying to get the information out there. And I think you were okay when you see me turn up, but I think the chap beside you thought, why does he want to come up and speak on the microphone? What is he going to say? But yeah.
I think you're it was not, it's not a case that in any way online radio and online media were, or alternative media, some people might call it, was being sidelined, but rather it was unwisely being omitted by accident, really, you know.
Totally. Well, that's why I wanted to kind of give it a shout, because there's people waking up new all the time, and they will go to a meeting but not necessarily know that there are radio stations online actually trying to wake people up as well. And so it's just reminding people as well that we're there and that we exist, and we're trying to get the information out, because I seen frustration on Facebook with people saying, oh, there should be a pirate radio station, everything else. I mean, basically they'll shut you down straight away if you start that act, doing pirate radio stations. But so far, internet radio stations, you can actually set one up yourself and do it, and there's no law against it. Now, what I was going to say to you was, you had the launch party Wednesday, and all the other groups are being set up as you speak. Where are you at now with covering the other counties? How's that going for you?
Okay, well, in terms of, it's important, I think, not only to have an abstract presence in the county of one or two people administrating a Facebook page, but also to have a very material presence there too, with artifacts, etc. So, we found is small and medium businesses, when they hear what we're about, they're offering office space. So we have office space and also a large hall offered in Monaghan Town, so that's Monaghan covered. We have a conference centre of sorts offered in Westmead, and also an office in Westmead. We have offices and workshop areas in Meath itself, in Louth, in three different towns in Louth, RD, Dundalk and Drogheda. And so that's the way we are expanding. And also the guys over in the West have office space, and we're sharing office space into the future, I think, with the Hub Galway. So we are expanding and getting a very physical presence. In terms of the work that we have to do to make the Louth model work elsewhere, and just to remind people what the Louth model is regular clinics, a weekly clinic, and ideally three towns in each county, where people can phone up, make a booking, come in where whatever their problem is, we try to press the pause button, come up with a strategy with them, and relieve their anxiety. Now, all we ask for this is that people get involved and spread the word themselves. We don't look for money or anything like that. Regular meetings, educational workshops on how to defend yourself, how to write a letter, how to read a letter, things like that. Now, on saying that, we know that it's a massive venture to take on over the next 2 months. Myself and others will be going around delivering train-the-trainer style workshops in all the local areas, and we'll be doing it with hardly the pants in our trousers, if you want to put it that way, I suppose. But because it's going to take time, we've set up a blog spot. And on that blog spot, you can log on, you can get all of our articles relating to the workshops we deliver. So we've converted those workshops into what we hope are easily understood articles, trying to identify points and stages where you might be, and giving you advice on from the basics upwards on how to deal with the position that you're in, you know.
Yeah.
So that's out there as well. The blog spot is, it can be found at, if anybody has a pen there, Landleague, LANDLEAGUE dot blogspot, BLOGSPOT dot IE. Now, there's one particular article up there for people who've just received the summons. And we know, in terms of people's mental health and well-being, that the receipt of this, and physical health, that the receipt of the summons is probably one of the most shocking and traumatic parts of the entire process. And so that article up there, we're asking people who have received summonses to read this before until their Christmas. It will alleviate some of the anxiety and stress. It will outline that this is a very long and protracted process, if you want to make it that way, and that you can stay in your home for years. There's a lot of people out there thinking that they're moving into the new year homeless, and we really need to alleviate that immediate shock for there's 50,000.
Yeah.
Well, really, well, for many people, you know, there'll be two on the mortgage document, so maybe 75,000 people right now this minute and their children don't know about it, and they can't look their children in the eye over this Christmas. So if they have a read of that, I'll give that again. It's Landleague, landleague.blogspot.ie. And if people could log on, have a read of the article, I think the title of it is Just Received a Summons, Don't Panic, Read This. So brilliant. Have a read of that if you're one of those people, please.
So that's two good bits of information. We'll have the Plonker book from Aidan and all about his letters his letters to the banks and everything else, and then the Blogspot as well. Now, the one thing that I will say is that you're setting up the Landleague in a way that's very democratic, which is very important because what you don't want is to have a kind of a system set up or a Landleague set up in a way that's the dictatorship. Do you want to talk about how it's very democratic?
Yeah, without going into too much of the internals of things at the moment, the Landleague, because of its potentials and possibilities, is open to people latching on to it with ulterior motives, if you want to put it that way. And so that has to, for the Landleague to work, the structures of the league really has to be set out, not only in stone, but very, very clearly. So what we've done is we've done up a draft constitution, which a provisional committee will be looking at. That provisional committee has representatives from most of the counties and will only exist until the 1st of June. But we've done up a draft provisional constitution, which we're still looking at the moment and knocking out and chipping away at. It's nearly complete. It will mean that no unit within the Landleague has the right to direct any other unit. So no national committee can direct a county committee. No county committee can direct a small area or a parish committee, other than with regards to following the constitution itself.
Yeah.
So there can be no dictatorships created.
Yeah.
The entire constitution is based on the concept of cooperation and consent, and about as well the idea that we all lead and are led through example. If we see something that's working somewhere, my area or your area can copy it, and you know that people can send out information about what everybody's doing to make it work. Because if anything tries to lead from the centre, what will happen is, like with all my doctoral specialist, my specialist in my doctorate was looking at organisational culture and leadership. And if it's ruled from the centre, it's just impossible at a national level to have the flexibility to be able to deal with situations, to be able to move the league on, to be able to change and evolve as the scene requires, you know. So we're very, very adamant that what develops around the country is democratic at a local level, that the local people control what they are doing and take responsibility for what they're doing as well.
Yeah.
So there's been a lot of work put into that.
Have you looked at the Michael Tellinger video I told you about?
No, and you know, it's been sent to me a couple of times, but every time I put my phone down from 7 o'clock in the morning till 11 or 12 at night, it bloody well rings.
Well, I'm not surprised, because there's a lot of people in trouble and a lot of people looking for help, and that's what the Landleague is there for. I have to say that you have been doing sterling work. I know I've been over there at the Landleague meetings, and you are the focal point, and I know you'll say, well, I'm one of a group of people, but you are the focal point and you're doing a lot of sterling work over there. So, you know, a big thank you, I'm sure, from a lot of people for yourself doing it. And, you know, as I say, you know, in the 1800s, when Michael Davitt started up, he sorted it out in 3 years, and he didn't have social media and communications like we do today.
Exactly.
So hopefully,
cards.
Yeah, exactly. So hopefully we can all kind of chip in. And if the listeners out there, you don't have to be struggling, or you don't have to own a house. So somebody said to me, I'd like to get involved, but I don't have a house. And I said, well, you don't have to have a house to get involved in the Landleague. I think she thought you were putting people up who were being evicted. But that was just...
All you have to have, it really, is a heart, you know. We appeal to a number of things. We appeal to logos, to ethos, and to emotion, really. To logic, to ethics, and to pathos, or to what people are feeling and going through. So we don't even try to appeal just at one level, because there's a very pragmatic element to what we are doing in terms of economics and in terms of society. So it's not just helping people at a personal level, though that is usually the coalface of what we do.
Yeah, well, I think for anybody who's never been in court, to go along and see how the justice is served out well, if you want to call it justice, because the last time I was in Trim Court, it wasn't justice, from what I've seen anyway. And we all agreed on that, what basically went on, what the banks were up to. So if you expect justice, then you'd be lucky to get it. But, you know, there are times
when
that
happens.
But we're
not working on that, and you know that as well. We've got a boycott letters off to all the solicitors in Dundalk, for a start.
Yeah.
We have letters off to the registrars of Meath and Louth, highlighting point by point their behaviours and how those behaviours and their special interests are in conflict with the concept of justice and law. And we really are starting to put them under pressure. And as you observed, and I think Francis, who has gone to court with you a number of times, has observed, their behaviours, at least within the courts, are changing.
Yeah, definitely. They are changing because they know they're being watched by us.
So we're working. It's working.
Yeah, yeah. Well, again, for the listeners, if you want to get involved, contact the local landlady or contact the landlady on Facebook. And get involved. If you have a few hours, get involved because it's well worth it. You meet a good team of people and a good camaraderie between everybody and you're learning at the same time.
We can actually give out. We have a dedicated mobile phone number, so this is not a personal number. This phone gets passed around. The workload always has to be shared. So we can give out that number if you'd like as well.
Well, we're going to finish up now, so I'm going to pass you over to Steve, and Steve's going to get all the details off again, just as a reminder. But again, thanks for coming on. Now, you're going to be on the show in probably 2 or 3 weeks' time, I believe, to do a full New Year kind of push for the 2015 Land League. And we'll get it out there. And again, thanks to the people in the Hub as well. I'm going to have to give them a mention as well.
Big time,
because the Hub are doing the same thing. And they're helping people and help so many people as well. And a big shout out to the people in the Hub. Well done for what you're doing there.
And the Anti-Eviction Task Force. And there's numerous groups around the country that are pulling together, hopefully under the umbrella of the Land League.
Exactly. And, you know, everybody's helping out. And that's what it's all. It's people power. Because there's no saviour going to come to save us. We're going to have to do it ourselves. Right, Steve, over to you.
Yeah, Finbar, great information. I just have one question. With all the information that you've been giving the people and the fact that you've been helping people, have you had many or anybody come up to you and be kind of less than respectful? Maybe someone who just gives you a mouthful because they don't understand what you're trying to do. Has anyone, like, any negativity?
No, not to me personally or to people I know, because I think logic, reason, and as I said, pathos is all on our side. What we are coming across is there is a new industry developed. Quite often those agents who are selling the mortgages and profiting from them, both solicitors and private broker agents, are now, they made their money while selling the mortgages. Now they're making their money hand over fist from evicting the same families.
Yeah.
And so we are getting reports back that these style agents are, you know, when people go to them in desperation and they say, well, what about the Land League or what about the Hub, that the response usually is to the effect, oh, those guys are just troublemakers, give us your €1,500. So that's the only negativity. We will be, I have no doubt into the future, we will have to face a lot of horrific and malicious criticism through media coming from special interests. But I was at Occupy, as so many people, other people were, and before that, we've been activists for a long time. We've gone through and we've toughened up our skin, and we are ready for the battle because we have to win this. 500,000 people. There's no even considering losing this battle.
Yeah.
No, you're right. You're right. I mean, I think your time is now. Definitely is. Maybe you're being guided from a higher power. Maybe Michael Collins is and
has your back.
And David, maybe they do have your back. Anyway, remember, we have the blog spot there, Land League, www.landleague.blogspot.ie. I have posted that up. I will post it up again. And you're on Facebook. You're on the anti-social media, as I call it. And you're going to give us the phone number as well.
Yeah, it's 089-474-0811. So that's 089-474-0811, and that phone line's open Monday to Saturdays. We'd have it off on a Sunday because we need a break of some sort. And as well as that, there's local Land League Facebook pages out there for each county. It is a medium. It's a way to get in contact. There will have to be face-to-face contact if this is really to happen, and that's what we are, you know, we're manifesting really in local areas. So, you know, make contact through the local Facebook page or through the blog spot or through the phone number. If there's no Land League in your area, and you feel that you've got a few skills to bring, we will link in with other people. We'll go down, we'll do what needs to be done to get the model up and running, and we'll get this country in the right track.
So all people need is, they just need to have the willingness to help other people. They don't need any special skill set, because, again, I'm guessing all training will be given.
Yeah, absolutely. And as I say, and I don't say this to be corny or patronizing. For a lot of people, to be able to hug a stranger is actually far more challenging than jumping over a river, believe it or not. And so the skill to be able to genuinely hug and take some of the anxiety from a stranger is something that we really need as well. Even if you can't read or write, or you feel that you don't have administrative skills that you may learn in the Land League, just get involved for being you. And I'm quite genuine when I say that now.
Brilliant. Okay, we have to go to a musical break. Okay, Finbar, thanks for being with us.
Thanks, guys.
Just stay with us there for a minute, and we'll pop over. What we have in some Christmas tune?
Absolutely. We're going to have a little wonderful Christmas time.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's do that. We'll catch you after.
This is Open Your Mind Radio on OYMRadio.com, UnitedWeStrike.com, and PeoplesInternetRadio.com.
And we're back. That was a short version of Wonderful Christmas Time. Mr. Paul McCartney.
Brilliant stuff.
Yeah, great information there from Finbar. Again, if anyone is interested in joining up with the Land League for the right reasons, because you want to help other people, you don't need any special skill set. Even if you don't have the confidence to do it, just having the spark is enough. Just contact the lads. And again, the phone number, it is popped up there on both of the chat rooms on PIR and also OAM. It's 089-474-0811. 089-474-0811. As Finbar said, the phone is on Monday through to Saturday. It's turned off Sunday because they need a rest. But just give them a ring, and you know, you could have a Land League or something going on in your own area.
That'd be very good. The chat facility, the OAM chat facility, for some reason during the evening was very slow. For some reason, I don't know why. Maybe it was being attacked. But it seems to be back okay now, back up to speed. These things happen. It's just one of them technical things. What can I say? Don't know why it went slow, but it could be the servers, maybe everybody at home now, maybe they finished work and they're all on the internet and they're checking up to see what gifts they can send each other. I haven't a clue, but it seems to be back up to speed. Now, next week we will be doing our annual review, and we'll have an extra guest in the studio with us. Mary's going to be joining us
for the first time in the flesh.
And we'll expect everybody in the chat to be black tie.
we will be checking, by the way.
We'll have the cocktails, and we'll have the hors d'oeuvres all ready to go when you turn up at 7 o'clock.
Be careful what words you're using there, will you? Because you know what they're like, and especially on the OAM chat. Anyway, you're saying we'll have the hors d'oeuvres and the cocktails. You know,
yeah.
Just some people will grab some of your words.
They'll dissect them.
They will
them
be used against you. Yes, yeah, agent, yeah. I'm talking about you.
Yeah, yeah. They'll be taken apart and go, well, that word means that and that, and that means the New World Order, and that means that they're going to kill you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, no worries. Okay, so that's really it for us. Just say, have a great Christmas, and don't get too drunk, and take it easy, and if you are driving, make sure you have a car.
I was going to do that one.
Ah, there you go. I didn't know. See, great minds think alike, you see. But, you know, have a good Christmas and stay safe, and don't do anything silly like drink driving and all that kind of stuff, you know. It's not worth it, especially with the way the guards at the moment. You don't antagonise them any further, you know.
Actually, I was up visiting my mother last night, real quickly, and I seen it. She had the TV on the background there. The kids were watching some programme. There was actually an advertisement saying the guards are now, they're going to be checking for drugs. But they're gonna drag you out of your car, and they now have the power, see me, to do all these, you know, the sobriety tests in relation to drugs as well, yeah. Not just alcohol.
Yeah, well, it doesn't surprise me. Did you see the video very quickly of the guy who went to tried to get into a nightclub, and the bouncers were there, and he was so drunk, the bouncer had a walkie-talkie with a rubber duck antenna on it, and he was pretending that it was an alcohol tester, and your man was so drunk he didn't know and start blown into the of the walkie-talkie.
No, I didn't say that.
That was classic. I mean, your man was, and he was going to say, I'm not drunk, and there he was blown into the antenna and the walkie-talkie. So there you go. So we hope you had a good Christmas. As I say, we do the annual.
We hope you had a good Christmas.
We hope you have.
But that's for those listening to the podcast after the 25th.
Oh, God. Yeah, okay. Yeah. We have a couple of days to go to get things sorted. Well, have a great Christmas, and we'll see you next week, as I say, with the annual review. It'll just before the 28th, I think, so before New Year's Eve. And take it easy, stay safe, I don't know who's on with Vin later. I didn't get any message back, so I'm sure who's ever on is going to be interesting.
I know.
Command the corner.
Yeah. It was there. Patrick Cullinan, I believe. I actually had it written down here. I think it's Patrick. Yeah, this Patrick Cullinan is going to be on with Vincent at 9 o'clock. So stay tuned for that anyway.
Yeah, don't eat too much. Take it easy and have a few drinks. And enjoy yourself. Again, a big thank you to everybody that tunes in to OIM. It's much appreciated. It really makes us enjoy what we're doing and want to do it more and get more guests on. Hopefully 2015 is going to be a good year. We have different people on, different guests planned. Bob Fletcher being one, who's an investigator, and he talks about the big stuff. And that's going to be interesting. He's in the States. So have a good one, and we'll see you next week. And as I say, take it easy from Alan James. Stay safe. Bye bye.
Yeah. Okay. That's the last. Stay tuned. Anyway, if you're listening on the PIR stream for Vin and Patrick Cullinan, we'll see you all again next week. As Alan said, have a great Christmas. Hope it's happy, healthy, peaceful, and you know all these positive things. There's just so much negativity going around today. So let's just put it all to one side, everybody, and. Have a great Christmas. From myself, Stephen George, we'll do it all again next week. Take care. Bye-bye.